There are many different ways to put a shelf of books in order, alphabetically, by author or by title, by subject or by the colour of the spine. Those are all valid approaches for different situations. If you're running a bookstore that has a lot of customers coming in and saying, oh, you know, I don't remember the title, but I know it was red, then sorting by colour is a reasonable approach. In 1876, an American librarian called Melville Dewey published a four-page pamphlet describing how he thought a public library should be ordered. Before Dewey, books in many libraries were ordered by when they were purchased. As new books arrived, they would just be allotted to a shelf or to a box that matched their size, and there'd be a central card file somewhere listing where everything was. You would have to ask a librarian if you wanted a certain book, and they'd retrieve it for you. Just browsing the shelves wasn't a thing. Dewey gave each subject an index number, and then said that the shelves should be ordered by that number. Over the years, the Dewey decimal system became a standard. Dewey had solved a serious problem, how to sort and find information without having to bother the head librarian. And because books were clustered by their subject, it encouraged general interest browsing of the shelves. Side note, while researching this, I found out that Dewey was a terrible person. Not in an, oh, but he was of his time way. He resigned from the American Library Association because of sexual harassment complaints in 1905. How bad do you have to be in 1905 to get kicked out? His sexist and racist biases made it into the early versions of the Dewey Decimal System. Lots of libraries these days use completely different classifications. But yeah, we do still remember his name. Anyway, here's the key point. By creating a useful index and sorting by it, readers could find books more quickly. That same principle of indexing applies to computers and has since the early days. There are two basic ways that a computer can search, linear and binary. Let's say you've got a stack of cards. They've got numbers on them that are somewhere between 1 and 50, and you want to find lucky number 13. If it's a shuffled stack, then there is no shortcut. You just run through looking at one card after another, after another, after another, until eventually you find number 13. That is linear search, going through every card in a stack, every element in a list, until you find the one or many that you're looking for. That'll work on any list in any order, but most of the time it will be slow. But what if the cards are in order by number? Sure, you have to spend some time to sort them. I've got a whole other video about that. But once you've done that, once they're in order, you can use a binary search. Binary not in the terms of like zeros and ones on disk, but binary in terms of splitting things in two. You look at the middle item of the list. Is it higher or lower than the number we're looking for, 13? So in this case, it's lower, so we can forget about the first half of the list and we can do the same again. Look in the middle of what's left. Forget about the side that we don't want. Look in the middle. Forget about the side we don't want. And so on, and so on, and so on, until eventually we find the card we're looking for, or we know that it's not on the list at all. Okay, with 11 cards, binary search doesn't make much difference, but with a million cards, it is lightning fast compared to linear search, provided that the list is in order. But a stack of cards is a simple example. A database is much more complex. Let's say we don't just have numbers on the cards, we also have letters, and let's add some colours as well. We can't sort the cards by more than one of those properties at a time. So right now, I can use binary search for number, but not for letter or colour. In the same way that librarians can sort their books by title or author or colour, you can only optimise for one property at a time. For everything else, you've got to run through every book on the shelf, every card in the stack, every item in the list. Unless you use indexes. Now, physically rearranging data on a hard disk, moving the cards around, that's called a clustered index. It's like making sure your dictionary is in alphabetical order, because that's mostly how you're going to use it. But a non-clustered index is like the index at the back of a book or a library catalogue. It's a separate store of just the property you're interested in, stored in a simple, easy-to-access format. If I want to find the card with the letter K on it, well, I can do a binary search through the index at speed, identify the number of the card, and then use another binary search to go straight to it. If I want to pull all the green cards, well, I can pull just those out of the color index, note down all those numbers, and then pull just those cards. There's no linear search happening anywhere. Again, it doesn't make much difference with 11 cards, but with 1,000 or 1,000,000 or 1,000,000,000, that's the difference between waiting hours for a response to your query and having it in a fraction of a second. Of course, each index that you add takes time to create and space to store. If your computer has ever been slow because of the indexing service on Windows or Spotlight Search on Mac, that's it taking the time to run through all your files and index all the properties that it can so that when you type something into your search bar, it'll be able to reply as quickly as possible. But every time you make any change to your database, if you add, remove, or change something, you also have to keep the indexes, whichever, up to date. So there's a skill in choosing which properties, which fields in a database you want to create indices for. If you're only going to search by color once or twice a year, it might not be worth indexing. As with many things in computer science, there is a trade-off between space and time. Now, Google say that their full search index is 100 petabytes in size, and they're customizing every result from it for every user, usually in under a second. Even after all the changes to Google over the years, even after all the space that they've given over to knowledge boxes and adverts, even after all the optimization that they've added to give the user exactly what they want, Google still put the time that it took to answer every query on every desktop search result, because they're still proud of it. Because the logistics and computer science skills required to do that are the sort of thing that PhDs are written about. Or because it's a trade secret, they're the sort of thing that commands very, very high salaries. It's a long, long way between Dewey and his decimal system and the Google search result, but the basic principle, create an index, is the same.